So I'm Jared Solomon. I'm the chair of this committee, Veterans Affairs and Emergency Preparedness. Let's do brief introductions.
Okay.
And then you'll give your testimony, and then we'll just have a discussion.
Okay.
State Representative Chairman. Mark Gillen, Minority Chair, Veterans Affairs and Emergency Preparedness Committee.
Sean Harris, Executive Director for Chairman Mark Gillen.
Connor O'Leary, Research Analyst for Mark Gillen.
Mike Hillman, Executive Director for Chairman Solomon.
Nancy Gans, State Representative.
Charity Harmon, PA National Guard Sapper Officer.
Gary Zimbauer, North Central Pennsylvania Region Sexual Assault Response Coordinator.
Greg, you want to?
Sure. Gregory Scott, represent Norristown, Conshohocken, and Plymouth Township in Montgomery County.
Carrie.
Hi, I'm Carrie Bonio. I'm the Research Analyst for Chairman Solomon.
Hi, and I'm Jamie Macon. I'm the Committee Secretary for Chairman Solomon.
We might as well just go around the horn. Go ahead.
I'm Danny Perkins. I'm a professor and run the Clearinghouse for Military Family Readiness.
Christy Brawley. I'm a researcher with the Clearinghouse for Military Family Readiness.
Thank you.
Dusty Duran, Fossil Ledge from Department of Military Readiness.
Thank you all for being here. I don't know who wants to go first.
I can start, sir.
Please, go ahead.
So we were asked here today to give a quick brief on what the PA National Guard is facilitating as far as sexual assault response and prevention for our service members, both Army and Air, as well as technicians, DOD contractors, and their dependents. So the program has been in place for close to a decade, really taking off in 2012 with some initiatives that came down from big Army, HQDA level, in order for us to set up a program that could respond to the issues of sexual assault in the military. There's been several revisions, including in 2021, the Independent Review Committee, after investigating the incidences surrounding Vanessa Guillen in Fort Hood, which has been renamed to Carvalhos. That IRC committee made recommendations to the DOD of 80 changes, including hiring full-time technicians to provide sapper services to the force. A lot of those other recommendations that came down include a new way of adjudicating sexual assaults in the military and putting it at a higher level to be an independent committee that would review the incident and take it out of the hands of commanders. So right now, the PA National Guard has 13 full-time technicians that serve under the Adjutant General, and we have approximately 100 more credentialed collateral duty victim advocates across the state. Did I leave anything out?
I don't think so. No.
So, thank you. Some of the new initiatives that are interest to commanders came out in January. So all of the active duty programs that get handed down have to be translated into PA National Guard and National Guard Bureau standards, because we are a civilian force that serves part-time, and so we fall under the PA Crimes Code versus the UCMJ. And so that's always a challenge for how to keep account of a crime that happens between our service members when they are part-time service members. So then we also have to work with the local jurisdictions, and there's 1,400 jurisdictions that have the first opportunity to investigate the crime, since we do not have military criminal investigative organizations such as CID, NCIS, OSI. And so we use our local jurisdictions to first investigate an unrestricted case, and then the command will respond and separate and insulate both parties, and then SAPR will come in and provide resources to that victim and advice to the command. The other triad of what we offer is we train the force on all current policies. Some of the new policies include expedited transfers, which is always tricky in the Guard. So we'll work with the command and find slots for that victim if they want to move, and we'll accommodate that move at their request. The Guard has also accommodated moving the alleged offender, if that's appropriate. So while we don't replace any of those agencies, we're the networking system between law enforcement, legal, the command, the client, the alleged offender.
Yes, so in my particular instance, I'm one of the regional SARCs, and what I'm First and foremost, if we have any victims that come in, that's the first priority, is make sure the victim gets all the resources they need. And in order to do so, I have taken on, for the area that in the region that I'm in, is going around and trying to get that collaborative effort. I've been to Center Safe, which is the local place here in Center County. I've been to the Mount Nittany Hospital to see what their process is to conduct the safe exams for a victim. Also up to UPMC up in Williamsport. And I've also have met with local police authorities, police chiefs of the townships. This morning I met with the lieutenant that is the head of the Pennsylvania State Police over here in Rockview. And then later this week, Thursday, because the facility you guys were out earlier at the Air Guard, there's also the Army National Guard building here, which is the building I work out of.
Are you able to find the building?
I do find the building very well, sir, yes. Thank you. But it actually is on Penn State property, so anything that happens at that armory on that piece of ground, it goes to the Penn State Police. So Thursday I meet with the Penn State police chief, and a lot of it's just going around and getting our name out and what our responsibilities are, and how, you know, we probably will end up working together at some point in time to just make that process as easy on the victims as possible. The other part of it is I'm also going around to the units that's in my region and doing that training to the soldiers in the, and not just to the National Guard, but also the Air National Guard, reaching out to the reserve units, because we are entitled, though, if we get a case of any type of service member, regardless of what service they're in, we have to give them the assistance that they need.
Thank you both. I just have a bunch of... Oh, of course. I just have a bunch of questions, and then we'll keep going, different members. So first, Charity, you mentioned the 2012 program. What was the 2012 program?
It was based on for the Army side, it was based on an HQDA XORD that was an adaptation of an executive order.
What does that mean?
It's all the way in which orders flow downstream from the president down, you know, Congress down, the NDAA, where we get our appropriations for money. It all flows downstream, and so as each level hacks off on it, and they produce an order for the subordinate organization.
Sure.
So for HQDA, they said, let there be a SHARP program at every major division. You have this date.
So it was the creation of the SHARP program.
That's correct.
For everyone here, can you guys explain what the SHARP program is?
Absolutely. So the difference there between SAPR and SHARP is the H, and the H stands for harassment. And so for the active duty Army, the victim advocates are trained, and the SARCs are trained, in order to respond to sexual harassment. There's a different set of procedures, and it's not a lesser degree of an incident, but now the DOD is looking at sexual harassment as a crime. So at the time, in 2012, it was you'll respond this way, and assault you'll respond this way, and here's all the procedures and forms and resources available to that client or, you know, victim or complainant. So the SARC and the VA could facilitate both SHARP, including harassment. In the Guard, we do SAPR, which most of the branches adhere to SAPR. Harassment's usually responded to by either equal opportunity or equal employment opportunity, and SAPR or SHARP respond to sexual assault. So it really depends on the status you're in. And for the Guard, we of course have many statuses. You can be in a full-time Guard status, such as our active Guard reserve force. You can be in a part-time status, which is our M-Day soldiers and airmen. You can go on Title 10 and be under force comm. So there's a lot of statuses we have to consider, because that's tied to their insurance. Now the nice thing for guardsmen is we can actually put a line of duty, which gives them insurance voucher for a year of care. And after that year, then they can go to the VA to seek care for that injury. So if they result with military sexual trauma, we can not only get them therapy, which is paid for by TRICARE because of that line of duty injury, then they can then go to the VA and continue their care so that they are treated for that injury.
The only tricky one that may be in there is because we get called to state active duty as well for in times of emergency, which is a complete different status. As far as the SAPR sexual assault response goes, we still do the same things, but when there's an injury or something that happens on state active duty, it actually goes to the workers' comp. So those instances goes to workers' compensation, and then how that gets paid is a little bit different than what the line of duty would be.
So 2012 was SHARP. What did the 2021 revisions consist of?
There was 80 different revisions. I'll be happy to provide that to whoever would like to review it. And it was all things that President Biden signed off and said, yes, we're going to do these things. We're going to take response.
What were the specific changes to the SHARP program?
The biggest change was the IRC then recommended full-time staff, such as Gary and myself. And so, let me quickly flash
our
map.
You both are a result of the 2021 changes.
We are. So these blue bubbles, and I know this is kind of tiny, but these blue bubbles here, these are all full-time staff members. And they represent full-time technicians or federal employees that are there 24/7 to respond to instances. So we will use our collateral duty part-time folks, but they have full-time jobs as well. Either they're civilian employees or they're AGR. So they only respond to SAPR issues on a collateral duty basis. And the technicians will work the problem from start to finish.
What are the numbers? So you've had these changes in programs in terms of success of these programs. So if you look at the 2012 number of sexual assaults, sexual harassment versus 2021, where with these big changes, which cost a ton of money, millions
yes.
of dollars
yes.
in investment, what are the numbers?
The numbers are the increased training.
No. Were the reported number of sexual...
Yes, sir.
Is that where you're going?
So the training then makes folks aware that someone did do something to me, such as they touched me in a private area, and that's actually sexual assault under the DOD UCMJ definition. So that brings that report to our attention, and that increases our numbers. And so as we continue as a
right,
force...
But what are the numbers? So how many...
So right
now...
We
go back to 2012, how many... reported as well as prosecuted for harassment assault beginning in 2012.
So as far as the numbers of folks, and I think it's on the back side of that paper, right now we have 55 cases that we're tracking in the PA National Guard that are...
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you. We have 55 cases that we are tracking in the PA National Guard that are open and receiving services. That's current. Of those, each month we give the tag an update, and so that is 25 unrestricted cases as of this month. So those cases get updated to the tag and the case management group council each month. As far as going back to 2012, those numbers are going to be lower because the staff was a total of 4 SARCs across the state, and so we had less training, less coverage. There was still collateral duty, but there was less.
But what can...
There was a heavy thing that happened in Horsham.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Absolutely.
They thought that the woman there was doing too well of a job. Okay? And then, so they got rid of her. And it was right after that that the commander was replaced and someone else was replaced there. The two men that really didn't like this woman. Now we have an incredible commander there. And trying to think of her name directly under.
Colonel Gray.
What is it?
Colonel Gray.
Yes. Very nice. And it's a completely different world now. So you're not going to have great numbers in 2012.
Yeah, so, and I'm a firm believer that from 2012 up to now, you'll see the numbers increase. I don't necessarily think that it's not because it wasn't happening in 2012. I think now that it's starting to get, the soldiers are getting educated and understand because, again, the dynamics of the military, you got soldiers who, and it gives back to part that's part of the program also, is the retaliation piece if you do report mm-hmm. and how that looks like. So I think now soldiers are more comfortable to come forward because the program's in place. They know that they can go forward with it. The emphasis with commanders are that this is a serious crime that's taking place. So now commanders are starting to understand that, you know, we have to take care of these victims because not only is it a violation of their physical space, they also have the repercussions of what it does to them psychologically as well. So I really think that now soldiers are more comfortable knowing that they have the resources to go to get help and they can report it. So I just think the reporting numbers are increasing because the soldiers, the program's in place and it's a lot better.
What do you mean position. 55 open cases?
So when a case comes in, it can come in from the individual reporting, they can call the state hotline, they can tell a leader, and the leader says, hey, there's options. Let me get you in touch with a SAPR. It's called No Wrong Door or Connect to Care. And so they have to refer the individual to a SAPR. SAPR does not, the individual, the victim does not have to give a report, but they at least have to be, they talk to a SARC or a SAPR, and we say, hey, this is what your options are. And usually we can pique their interest in something there that is something that will help them get back to their best self. So however the case comes in, and it can be years later that the case comes in. So the report, you know, it comes in 2023, but it happened in 2021. So when the case comes in, we sit them down with a credential, DSACP, which is DOD credentialing program that the National Organization of Victim Advocates runs for the DOD. And that SARC will sit down and walk them through all the resources on a reporting preference statement, which is a DD-2910. Once they fill out that report, they can say, I want to go unrestricted, which allows them to make a report to law enforcement. The SAPR will go with them if they would like them to, or they can go restricted, which means they get all the resources except for a law enforcement investigation or an expedited transfer. And they have all those resources available to them. They can have a special victims counselor, which is an attorney to help respect their rights and communicate the military justice process. They can have a line of duty. They can have free therapy. There is just a plethora of things we can do. We can help intercede with their command.
So the 55 includes all of that?
That is open and receiving services. So at about a year, the case, if it's gone unrestricted, may be at the point where it's ready to be adjudicated. So even the IRC report from Fort Hood showed that even active duty has a 365-day turnaround for their investigative. CID takes a whole year to adjudicate a sexual assault case. And at that point in time, it may or may not move forward when the civilian prosecution. If civilian prosecution cannot move forward, then the TAG has the opportunity to ask the Office of Complex Investigations, which is a National Guard-run bureau, to have their investigators come in and do an administrative investigation to possibly hold non-judicial punishment for that alleged offender.
And for so that sexual process, assault, you can do non-judicial punishment?
After the criminal charges have not been able to move forward.
So after the DA says, hey, we're not going to be charged, we don't have sufficient evidence to bring forward the case, right. CID comes through. Well, CID is an option. CID looks at it and then administratively can pursue.
Unfortunately for the Guard, unless they were in a Title 10 status, we do not have the option of the MCIOs like CID and OSI. If it is active duty, it happened downrange, absolutely they get first crack and they do a fabulous job. But for the PA Guard, when it happens home station or happens when they're not in a Title 10 status, we do refer to local law enforcement if that victim's able to participate in the investigation.
But if you're drilling, you're under the UCMJ.
Negative,
no?
Sir.
No, no sir. Not so. So the National Guard's under Title 32. Again, just a different title and different pot of money. They, for Pennsylvania, they fall underneath our own Pennsylvania Military Crime Justice, PC.
You got it right.
Yeah, Permanent Crime of Military Justice.
It's UCM, a Title 18.
Yeah,
Title
18. Title 18. UCMJ only falls for if you're on Title 10 and active duty status.
So I'm just trying to figure, because I'm in a TDS unit, what are then the cases coming in where we're dealing with sexual assault?
So when we say we deal with them, we respond to them, we offer resources, we make sure the TAG's aware, and then we go with them. If they'll let us go with them to the law enforcement investigation, we're there for them every step of the way.
What is the trial? What are we, like, what, when you're saying, what, are we then just assisting
yes.
the district, the civilian prosecution?
By giving that victim a victim advocate and helping them understand the process, go with them. If there's no victim witness liaison in the DA's office, we make sure that we're there for them to be a support system. And so as it moves through the criminal court case, it'll either result in, you know, a criminal prosecution or it will not. If it's not able to go, and even if it does, the TAG can still request OCI, the Office of Complex Investigations, come in and look at that administrative and decide whether or not it's either founded or unfounded. So a lesser degree, it's not the preponderance, it is a preponderance, it's not beyond a reasonable,
reasonable doubt.
Yeah. Thank you. And then
where do you both fall in the chain of command?
I report directly to General Kadelka, who's our joint commander, and the TAG, and Gary is my direct report.
Okay.
So we're supposed to have unimpeded, and we have not had an issue.
Right. You're not independent, of course, right?
No.
So you fall under a chain
absolutely.
Of command.
Right, yes.
Absolutely.
If I may, I mean, part of the challenge, I think, is the defining what sexual assault is. Because, again, the military views sexual assault as a problem, where that occurs
if that occurs in a on a drill weekend, the local law enforcement may be asked to come. They'll come in. The most they'll likely do is a report because it, to them it's not a crime. But then it goes through the administrative process as well. And that's when you look at the challenges, it's, you know, when you hear sexual assault, most people assume that it is an assault, whereas some of them are, but most of them or some of them are also this inappropriate touching or some sort of contact that was inappropriate.
Right.
So I have a question. I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman.
No, go.
So just with respect to, you know, we are a vast state. The National Guard has operations in almost all 67 counties. All of our district attorneys across the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania are resourced differently according to, you know, the finances and the resources of that particular county and then the philosophical differences of those individual DAs. And then when you add on to it the police departments, where we don't even know how many police departments there are in Pennsylvania, the amount of police departments and the philosophical differences of the police departments, I'm wondering the barriers that you all have encountered during this program with interacting with different jurisdictions who interpret the law, you know, 100 different ways, and how does that impact your work with respect to the servicemen and women that you're dealing with?
It's a great question. Thank you. It is always different, and it is subjective, at least in the respect that those professionals know their business. We do find that in the larger metropolitan areas, such as when we had the Protect DC mission, and we were working with DC Metro, that's a major metropolitan PD. Inappropriate touching, such as grabbing someone's butt or groping, is not nearly as serious a crime as it is sexual assault, but it is not the major crime that they would usually respond to, say for a rape or sexual assault crime. And so that major metropolitan department is challenged for how to treat those two different ends of the spectrum with the same level of, like, for example, that sort of groping would be considered simple assault under, I know the Fort Indiantown Gap Police consider that simple assault, might be a ticketable offense. Whereas rape would, of course, be a major crime in most jurisdictions, if not all. And just how they respond to that. It also depends on how they interact with the victim and if the victim can fully participate with the questions. In our training, we learned that a victim sometimes has to tell their story 18 different times. So Jesus. As sappers, we try very hard not to ever ask more than we barely need to know. Yes, that sounds like harassment. Yes, that sounds like assault. Let me get you the right agency. Let me do a warm handoff. We're dealing a lot with domestic violence now, so we're working with our local shelters and those domestic violence victim advocates to help us work through safety planning, but we still handhold to get them through the process so they have a consistent person they can share what's going on and we can network solutions. So as far as the jurisdictions, yes, based on the range of a sexual assault going from an inappropriate groping to penetrative rape, it's understandable why some police departments respond differently. Now, the smaller jurisdictions will see an impressive reaction, especially when there's major crimes occurring in their small hamlet, and they'll take that prosecution 3 years, but they generally end up at a good result. But unfortunately, even from that IRC report, prosecutorial rates are usually 22%, and then the actual making the charges stick is down around 11%. So if you have, you know, any kind of population, we of course don't lead with those statistics. It's just what they found when they did their investigation.
Got it. And then, so I know that not all of our campuses are, I can't think of what the sites are called, but have MPs on them too. But adding that level is also complex due to the guard status and all that kind of stuff. And then they don't have prosecutorial authority, correct?
The MPs won't get involved.
Got it.
So, again, being where we're at with the different units, I think there's an MP unit out towards Johnstown and then the one down at Harrisburg.
Fort Indiantown.
Yeah. So they will not get involved. That's really not their jurisdiction because they don't have jurisdiction on it. Now, if it happens within their unit, obviously they're going to be involved. But as far as going to another unit and stuff, that's not part of the process.
Go ahead.
It's within the local jurisdiction at that point.
Yeah. So how one of the bills that we were working on exploring is having certain reportable offenses report prosecutorial discretion heading straight to the Attorney General's office, right? To at least give some broad, we're having some issues with transportation and, you know, it's hard to find police officers for these departments and they've got to work with five different DAs in the Southeast. So one of the things that was explored. So I'm curious to think if you have any reactions or have given any thought to at least from a prosecutorial standpoint.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. So we worked hand in glove with our state SJA office, which advises the TAG and the leadership on the proper execution of the PCMJ and, when appropriate, the UCMJ, as well as what responses they can take to uphold good order and discipline for the part-time force and what status they're in and what commanders can do. For example, a military no-contact order is not appropriate 28 days out of the 30. However, the commander can still do a counseling statement and say, you will do these things, and I, as your commander, are telling you you have to do them. So that's pretty compelling for that soldier or airman to follow suit. Also, if they're a named subject of an investigation by local law enforcement, they can be flagged, and so they do not get special favors or promotions or awards. Going back to your question, as far as what our SJA is doing, our state judge advocate general, he is working with the state Office of Inspector General, as well as with the PSP, in order to figure out, one, if the PA National Guard can be identified as a criminal investigative body so they can receive those reports and then hand off from local law enforcement to OCI, the Office of Complex Investigations. That'll be a great network of what's been done to what the administrative body can now do with that information. So they'll pick up where the local law enforcement left off. The other thing they're doing is they're working with the PSP to see if we can have one responsive body to all unrestricted cases of sexual assault. So that instead of going to 1,400 jurisdictions, we would go to the PSP. They would decide which jurisdiction it falls into and whether or not they were going to respond to that major crime or pass it off to the local law enforcement in that jurisdiction. So those are two efforts that I'm aware of.
Sir?
Yes, we have become, right, the biggest challenge we had up to about 4 months ago was that the Adjutant General could not even receive the criminal reports or the police reports. Since then, we have become a law enforcement entity where we can at least request and receive those reports, so that could be part of the his determination or when he's making a determination. We are working primarily with the Pennsylvania State Police on the criminal side to ensure that we have a one organization that has a standardized way of handling criminal investigations. We are also in discussions with the Commonwealth IG office when it comes to the investigations. They do administrative investigations. So if it is not a criminal investigation, it starts off as administrative. Of course, it could turn to criminal, or a criminal could turn to administrative, and they would exchange roles and responsibilities for that. Those are still in discussions. We have not been able to get to a point of agreement, but we would likely do that with a MOU or some agreement between the agencies.
Yeah, well, I'm definitely interested in exploring that. I mean, I think that as a victim of sexual assault, for me to have to recount 18 times my assault, and in terms of dealing with the courage to even come forward to speak about it, then having to work with people who, we all know that these units are very small and people talk, so as confidential as confidential is kept, right? Having one place where at least one of these SARCs can pick up the phone and call the AG's office, the Attorney General's office, and say, hey, we have this complaint, and let them come down. I mean, I look at it similar to the way, and where Nancy and I come from, we've got a great group called Mission Kids, which kind of spearheaded the way. Whenever there's a child sexual assault or childhood trauma like that, child beating, they talk one time to a trained counselor, the prosecutors in the other side, the detectives in the other side. We need to do better.
So the team here at Mount Nittany Health, I went in there and talked to their director that handles all the sexual assault cases that comes in there. The first thing that impressed me that they do is that every one of their emergency nurses have to get qualified to do the safe exam, where most hospitals either have somebody on call or you only have one person.
Right.
They make every one of their emergency nurses do that. The second piece is she will wait until all the players are there before they get through the questioning so that victim doesn't have to relive that multiple times.
Good.
The police is there, well, you know, myself as a SART being there, and whoever else needs to be there. They do their own line of questioning, and she makes sure that everybody is part of the player that team is there so that victim doesn't have to relive that up to 18 times.
Thank you. Thank
yes,
you
sir.
For your work.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Really Chairman Gillen.
First of all, thank you so much for the work that you're doing, because I think in a very real sense, the attention, the light of day that's being shined on this issue is raising the bar of accountability and awareness, and is helping people to come forward. You mentioned 80 changes. I know when I have a spare weekend, my wife has 80 projects for me to do.
Yes.
And at some level, there has to be a taxonomy established when you have 80 different items. Has there been a delineation? It's all important, all ought to be done. But in terms of the prioritization, how is that being managed?
It's a struggle, sir. As the DOD SAPRO, which is the overarching body that advises the DOD, and they, of course, have experts like Dr. Galbraith,
mm-hmm.
who Gary was able to meet this past week at the National Organization of Victim Advocate Conference, which is held in New Orleans. He helps advise that body. And then from the field, myself as a state SAPRO officer, the 54 states and territories are able to participate in a national SAPRAC board. So we feed problems and concerns and best practices from the field up to the DOD SAPRO as well as National Guard Bureau. As far as what rolls out first and what's the priority, we've seen updates to our victim preference reporting statement. We've seen 4 changes this year alone without version control. So that's always a challenge. And the DOD forums have their own metric as to when a version control is actually warranted. So we've seen forms updated, we've seen positions be allowed to be hired for, we've seen training improve for those full-time technicians, we've seen overhauls in the collateral duty training. There's lots of policy changes once they're adapted from DOD level down to a National Guard perspective. We'll see new CNGBIs and CNGBMs, which are instructions and manuals from the chief.
I know it's hard.
Yes.
I mean, even being in the military, when you're doing the acronyms,
yes.
can you explain to everyone
Absolutely.
What you're talking about?
Absolutely.
Because I'm getting
Absolutely.
Completely lost.
So
thank you.
The
Thanks
DOD
so
SAPRO is the Department of Defense Sexual Assault Prevention Response Office, and then they advise the subordinate echelons from DOD and all the branches and the National Guard. So the CNGBM and the CNGBIs are Chief National Guard Bureau instruction and manuals, and they're derived from the DOD, which is the Department of Defense, instructions and manuals. And all of those flow down. So we'll derive the way we run the program based on those overarching regulations and then how they're adapted for our force. And so as we've talked about earlier, the National Guard Bureau has challenges with our part-time force and the codes in which we operate under and the laws that govern us. And so one of the largest challenges goes back to law enforcement, where we do have to rely on the local law enforcement to uphold the state laws in which we operate. And so that's always a challenge for those regulations to go from a UCMJ body, which is very easily, you know, enforced under Title 10, to a Title 32 body, which we fall under the Title 18 codes. And
thank you. Just a couple of very brief questions. How well do you cross-pollinate? Let's suppose somebody calls the National Sexual Assault Hotline or another national number. You're able to circle around well. You have good relationship with those entities, and there's cross-pollinating communication?
Yes, sir. So I sit on the SAPRAC board that advises National Guard Bureau, and so we work to know each other. And so if I have a case, for example, we had a harassment case occur at the Gap, which is Fort Indiantown Gap, and it was an Army Reserve Title 10 officer. The alleged offender or the respondent was a National Guard Texan, and the higher echelon was New York Division, 42nd Infantry Division, all operating under on Pennsylvania. So what we did is we figured out what it was going to look like. We did the intake, and now we started to hand that off to the different agencies. New York recommended that we send it over to Texas. So it makes sense for all of us to be able to pick up the phone. And National Guard Bureau works very hard to keep those numbers updated, but then we also do grassroots projects as well to keep in touch with each other.
We all have the highest regard for our military at every different level. And I think it's fair to assess there's a very low percentage of individuals who are involved in criminal activity, including sexual assault. By the same token, if I look at national statistics, in 2021, there was a rise in reported sexual assaults. What is your take in terms of, we have an awareness level that's much higher. We have reporting that I'm assuming is at a higher level than it had been in the past. So when I look at a statistic like that, am I seeing more reporting rather than more crimes?
That's absolutely what most of my peers and professionals that serve in this capacity believe, that we'll come out of a training, the victim will come up to us afterwards or the next day, they'll call the PA Sapper hotline and will let us know, hey, I think I was a victim. And so we'll walk through what happened, we'll do the intake, we'll say, yes, you absolutely were. You know, based on what you're sharing with me, what would you like to do? Here's your resources, here's your reporting preferences. Which way would you like to go? Do you want to go to local law enforcement? Do you want to keep it restricted? So.
Yeah, and I think, you know, since the program has gotten to the point where it's at now and we're doing a lot more training out with the units to get a better understanding of, is it happening more or are they just starting to report it? I think it might take a few more years to look at those numbers to see, you know, if the numbers start going down, you know, the number of reporting we have, numbers start going down with the way the program is set up now. I believe that the numbers will start going down because, yes, maybe it is happening less because now people, I don't think we've hit our peak yet. People are more comfortable reporting now since we're going around. And I said, I'm going to brief 12 different units probably in the next 4 months and every soldier in his units of what sexual assault is. And as Charity just said, we'll probably see a couple of cases come out of that after we brief. But I think we probably haven't seen our peak yet. But if we're doing our job correctly and the commanders are doing their job correctly, I would say that, yes, the reporting is making the numbers higher now, and then we may see that decrease as people become more aware and understanding what it is and what the circumstances are.
Yeah.
And as they mentioned, most of the reporting is things that have occurred in the past.
Yep.
And they're just now taking action.
Catching
from
up,
it.
Yeah.
So it's hard to delineate what occurred before and what's occurring today.
But just a very brief closing comment. I thank you for the outstanding work that you're doing. I have 5 daughters, and I've got one is midstream in a college ROTC program. So
excellent.
The import and the value and the efficacy is felt within our own family unit. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Just wanted to this chart. So when in the conversation you were talking about, someone comes up to you, if the case is closed, does that go into the number, the reported numbers that are on here?
Yes. So DOD has a system of record called the DSAD, which is the Department of Defense Sexual Assault Incident Database. And so every case of sexual assault that occurs in the DOD goes into that database. We have our own location code, so it's very specific. We can see what PA cases are occurring in our footprint, or they're transferred into, say, someone coming home from deployment or moving from guard to guard. When the client says that a year, they say, hey, I'm okay, I'm good for now. Now, we'll always serve them. We'll always serve them. We'll also give them resources to go to the VA and take their 2910 and add that MST, that military sexual trauma, to their potential VA comp and pen claim for, you know, future benefits. But when they say I'm good, we'll say, hey, we'll always be here for you, but we're going to close your case, and it's officially closed in DSAD. If it was unrestricted, it needs to have an adjudication from law enforcement. What happened? Was it unfounded? Was it prosecuted? Was it under a PA code, or was it one of the Title 10 UCMJ codes, which they have rape, sexual assault, sexual abuse, abuse sexual contact, that sort of thing. So when it's closed, we can always reopen it with the help of our higher office at NGB, but then it is actually a case that's closed, and they track those metrics all the way up through Congress so that it's something they can roll up in the DOD report every year to Congress.
When does the, so if you report, when does the command get notified?
So when it's an unrestricted report, we have 48 hours to tell the TAG, and we do a, we don't recommend a serious incident report. We recommend it's a verbal from commander to commander, especially if the commander was the one that helped bring the case to SAPR to get resources for that victim. If it comes through SAPR, we then do the five W's. We give them the who, what, when, where, how, and what we're doing to help the victim, their well-being, what they need, what they've accepted. And then we make sure they know that this is a law enforcement agency that's investigating. We add it to the case management group. It gets touched monthly and updated as the life of the case moves forward. If it's restricted, we still let the TAG know within 48 hours that we have a case, it's a PA guardsman, and this, you know, they're safe, they're okay, and we're giving them services. Or if there's a safety concern that concerns them either hurting themselves or someone else, it cannot stay restricted, and then we seek services and make sure they stay safe.
Do you ever have an instance, you know, obviously if a particular member of the guard is out for a period of time, there might, and rumors travel quickly. How does that impact the sort of good order and morale of the unit?
If the victim's away from drill because they're too anxious to attend drill, we have a procedure in place where we work with the commander, even if it's restricted, because now that DODI instruction that came down in 2021 allows commanders to be aware of a restricted case and it stay restricted, which is fantastic. We weren't sure how it was going to work out, but it's worked marvelously, especially in situations where the soldier or the airman cannot come to drill because they're too anxious. We'll set up SUDAs, which is a alternate substitute drill. They'll get credit so they can have a good year, and those credits can be either online training, appointments, therapy, working through an MEV packet to see if they're still fit for duty to stay in, and our SAPRs are starting to help the unit and the victim through those packets, which are kind of lengthy. So those are some options. And when, back in about 21, we were seeing a lot of, they're just not coming to drill, and we quickly addressed that to try to make sure, in accordance with the state surgeon cell, that they were coming to, they were getting good credit for the drill, even if they're not participating in uniform with that unit. And as far as rumor mill, one of the largest barriers to victims reporting is the rumor mill.
Sure.
So we're very deliberate. We give advice to commanders, and we on no certain terms tell them they need to put out, you know, the folks that are involved are strictly need to know, and everybody else needs to keep their mouth shut. And so we give that advice from us to the commander. They should always seek SJA support, the staff judge advocate, to get legal advice on what they should do with the alleged offender to insulate and separate both parties. But we will very directly tell the commander they need to keep this close hold.
And how do commanders take that advice, and how do you see it operating at the unit level?
For being in this role for the last 3 years, I've never fails to impress me how well our commanders respond appropriately. They may not know what to do, but they always know who to call. And once they get us, they use us as a lifeline, and we'll walk them through from start to finish on how best to facilitate that case, because they do not want to make a mistake and make it worse for the victim or end up, you know, mistreating the case. Very impressed with how our commanders respond.
That's great.
I recently was on the other side of that with the command and the, you know, they coming through the unit and working its way through the command leadership and stuff, and I can honestly say that my experience there was that it does stay, there's a tight hold on it. Usually there's any, the commander, usually his command sergeant major's right hand guy, and then the, each brigade has a staff judge advocate that they talk about these cases each month, even within those own unit brigades, and those are really the only people I know about it.
What if, if I may, what if it's the commanding officer or unit commander that's the alleged perpetrator?
That's a good question.
Then how do you go up the chain of command?
Yep.
I most recently we've had an Ohio unit that was drilling on Fort Antietam Gap for annual training, and it unfortunately was the captain who assaulted a platoon leader, a lieutenant in his command. Fortunately, that brave soul, she was able to make sure her leadership knew. Folks got her to the hospital. We were able to get them linked up with a PSP to be able to give a report. And because the crime happened in Pennsylvania, it'll be adjudicated in Pennsylvania. But then what the Ohio unit did to remove that individual, that commander was removed from command, flagged, put into a role in which they could not be in contact with troops. And fortunately, the lieutenant was moving on from that unit to another unit. And so she had some separation from the situation. But geographically in the state, they're also separated, but PFA was put in place by the Ohio SAPR team, and so we did that transfer and warm handoff back to the home station unit.
what is the communication process when that happens? Excuse me. So if it is their unit commander or commanding officer, who do they go to?
Who does the victim go to?
Yeah, how do they make that that leap?
Yes.
I request mass.
Yes.
Okay. How do they get there without, if the intent is to keep it quiet and
yes.
protect the victim?
We are seeing a very positive lack of tolerance of bad behavior, toxic leadership, inappropriate comments, touching, relationships. We're seeing grassroots from the lowest level say, I'm not going to tolerate it. And so even though it seems like a very direct line of the chain of command from that lieutenant to the commander, that lieutenant had her battle buddies, both of which stayed with her for the whole evening, and it got through the NCO channels up to battalion and then trickled back down to make sure that they separate and enslave both parties. So even though there is a very direct line of chain of command, there's also so many other options to address a problem. And it doesn't end with the commissions. It can be an enlisted commissioned officer. It can be special support staff like the chaplain or sapper in this case. And it lack a very much increase in a no tolerance for that misbehavior and just bad conduct.
And that's part of our job too, as we're going out training these units and training the soldiers, is to get those soldiers to understand that, hey, if there's somebody in the leadership position, you know, and we do a lot of scenario training, and it's somebody and the scenarios are real, scenarios that happen. And if it's a leader of that soldier, okay, who do you go to next? Get them to understand that, hey, if it's your platoon leader, you need to go talk to your first sergeant or your company commander. You know, if it's a brigade commander or someone in that chain, and it'll probably be with somebody on that staff, needs to call the commanding general of the division or the tag or someone that's above that and say, hey, look, here's the situation we got. And then as far as the process remains the same. You know, we help the victim at that point, you know, where the next command has been identified, it's then falls on them to start the investigation on their end, how it follows. And then as a SARC, we just follow the same process of getting that victim in there and helping that victim to get what they need.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I know that you had mentioned the different classifications of the airmen and the guardmen depending upon where they are at in the process and drilling and all that kind of stuff. I'm just curious about the treatment, right? Depending upon where they're at, they get TRICARE, they may get state programs, maybe workman's comp. Where are the gaps and how can we help streamline that?
Oh, thank you. The biggest gap we see is when an assault occurs and that individual is not in a status. Maybe they were on holiday, they were down in a large military community like Fort Sam Houston or San Antonio, and they believe the offender's military, but they were in a vacation status, they were on leave, or they were just civilian traveling between drills. So they're largely without coverage. Now we'll continue to serve them, they get a victim advocate, they get a special victims counselor, they get the command to help, everything's there, but we cannot cover them insurance-wise. So that's a large gap. We will work with our community partners. We will work with state grants. We reached out to Texas Crime Victims Compensation Fund to try to reimburse that. Because unfortunately, the first hospital that victim hit did not have a safe nurse on staff. So then they had that ER bill and they moved to the next hospital, which a SARC was involved in and got them to an ER that could do a safe exam. Unfortunately, that bill followed. You know, there was collections notices, and then there was a suicide attempt, so it just kind of snowballed. Fortunately, the system in place from the readiest NCO in the organization that the soldier serves in to sapper in the command, everyone came together to be part of that solution for the soldier. And our state line of duty officer, Mr. Unger, is truly a magician. He will help any soldier or any soldiers for him. But our airmen as well have this opportunity to have line of duty. So that's a gap that I'm at least aware of.
So if they're on vacation and this happens to them, we don't insure them?
They have to be in a status.
You have to be in the duty status. So if they're not like in a drill status or in an annual training status.
Or AGR.
Or AGR, if they're not in a status, they have to rely on either their insurance.
If they have it.
So it gets even worse. If they don't have it, then it even becomes a bigger problem.
And this is even included in transit. So I have orders to go. I'm showing up. I gotta be in Dallas, Texas on Saturday for drill. And I'm gonna leave on Thursday. I'm traveling, I'm in transit. I get there early.
I'm on base, but because I'm not supposed to be drilling until Saturday, and I'm assaulted Thursday night into Friday, I'm not covered.
So as far as that line of duty, the SARC inputs the line of duty, we will make sure that individual gets taken care of because they were in a position, they were there because of drill. So we will not let that go. We will take care of that. But as far as like when they are truly on leave or between drills and they have hospital bills that are associated with that, it's a little bit harder to try to move that window.
So if a soldier was going to drill, and I'll use this as an example, if a soldier was going to drill, and I know when I was out in the western part of the state, we had soldiers coming to Hawaii from Virginia traveling to drill. If they are traveling to the point to where they have to have drill, that travel time is included in their coverage. So if they get like in a car accident, all right, they still get paid to get that line of duty. I mean, we don't take care of the car for them, but that we can put a line of duty in to help pay for their emergency if they have to get an emergency room. So their travel time going to drill and then from the time they leave drill to get home does have some coverage if something should happen to them as far as medical expenses.
If I may, an example, I think that and I correct me if I'm wrong, where it may happen, many of our National Guard members are students. So if it happens on a campus, for example, while they're a student, if they're in the National Guard, they're still going to get the support.
Yep.
But they're not going to get the line of duty and the insurance is not going to cover them. The military insurance is going to cover them in that case.
So in Pennsylvania, when we have those scenarios, I know we have the Office of Victim Advocate. Have they been responsive? And does that pot of money typically cover those costs?
On that case I was referencing from Texas, we did not use OVA, the Office of Victim Advocate, for that case. We thought more the Crime Victims Compensation Fund of Texas was appropriate. All's well that ends well, we did get those bills paid and got that debt off of that soldier's back and made sure that they had the care and resources they needed. As far as OVA, they've been very responsive, spoken to several of those folks on different cases. We just have not crossed into requesting funds for any of our cases yet because most of the time we're able to find coverage, but that is a known gap that we've seen in our experience.
What have you given any thought to some proposed solutions? I'm really curious, because it's such a conundrum, right?
Yes.
I mean, it's not a one-size-fits-all,
yes,
which is probably why we're here, but maybe there's some tweaks to the victim's advocate jurisdiction and parameters.
We are constantly looking for ways to help the leadership, the command, because we're not medical professionals, but we can help a victim understand what's needed. For example, when that line of duty is part of a larger medical evaluation board, we'll have a SARC work with the victim to collect all the releases of information necessary from their clinical providers that may be civilian to put all of that information into their medical evaluation board packet. And while we're not medical professionals, we know how to read a checklist and explain what's being asked and help that client go and get what they need to get. And that way that medical evaluation board packet can go forward. Once it's in the process, it also dovetails with the VA so that history goes then to the VA for their comp and pen evaluation. But that's for folks that have hit the point of not being fit for duty. They need to be evaluated whether or not they're going to remain or be given an evaluation disability separation. Hmm. So we have about 7 clients right now that we're helping through that process out of a population. We usually see about 30 cases a year, but we're seeing a tremendous uptick in domestic violence. And most of those do not have a sexual component. And so right now, we will continue to find gaps, but right now we're just responding to what's coming in. And as our force grows and our education level increases with our regional SARCs, and we divide the state into 6 because our commands are so southern tier heavy. If we were to put 2 GS-12s in Horsham, one for the 56th Brigade and one for the 111th Air Wing, that seems a redundancy, where instead we moved Gary's spot to State College, so we have regional coverage in the north central section of the state. And that made more sense based on where we're geographically dispersed as far as organization. So as we continue to build our team and build the education and knowledge of that team, we'll definitely start to have more ways and ideas of how to move forward towards prevention. And we have an integrated prevention workforce now, which is part of that IRC recommendation. And so that force right now is headed up largely by technicians that'll be based out of some of these major command elements, and they'll think forward to primary prevention, where what we teach is secondary prevention. They'll be looking at the statistics and evidence-based information so they can actually get ahead of the incident.
Thank you again for what you guys do.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much. I was in the Army, stationed at Fort Riley, Kansas, back in the 70s, and when I was severely sexually assaulted there, it took them about 3 weeks and they put me on a plane to Germany. But it was never put out there to the police outside of the base, nothing like that at that time. So I'm very grateful for you.
Thank you for sharing that, and thank you for your service. And I'm sorry that you had that experience. And
it's okay. You know, it was a long time ago, but I got to go to Germany.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
The insurance issue that, how many folks are we talking about that fall in that gap per year?
I think as our numbers increase, because our soldiers, and airmen are traditional soldiers and airmen, only drill 2 days a month typically, I think as our reports increase, that percentage of undercovered population will increase. I always ask, hey, are you using your TRICARE Reserve Select, which is a great benefit to our guardsmen? And I get about 50-50, and that really depends on how much they're able to bring home. I see a lot of underemployed service members, very talented individuals that just have not found the right employment opportunity to complement their service. So that usually drives their decision whether or not they're going to buy groceries or have insurance. And so I think we'll continue to, that percentage will increase, sir, is my
opinion. I'll go back to the students that we have. Many of our National Guard members are students. They do fall to the parents, but a lot of times they don't want to report.
Yes.
Because they don't want the parents involved.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's true. There's still a tremendous amount of shame.
Age 26.
Yes, sir. There's still one of the barriers is shame. They're worried what people will think. There's always, we still see victim blaming, unfortunately, even in enlightened and trauma-informed society we hope to live in. We still see victim blaming. Why were you there? Why didn't you have a plan? Alcohol is almost always involved in our sexual assaults, and so typically inhibitions are lowered, consent is inebriated. So we do know there's a lot of typical characteristics of the sexual assaults. Typically they're under age 30. Their offender is typically the same age or in a position of supervisory within their rank. So there's a lot of similarities in the statistics that we hope to provide to OSG, OIG, so they can take that back and hopefully continue to insulate the committees with information from our statistics that we have. Everything available, we're working on making sure that all those are redacted names, but then the statistics, genders, ages, hopefully that's all available. It's a work in progress.
Any materials you could share with the committee would really be helpful.
Absolutely, sir.
Wrap that through Dusty.
Absolutely. It's very much our intent. We're just...
No.
We are all hands on deck, and everyone's moving the same direction. So it's absolutely our intent to share that both with our prevention workforce and our state partners and our legislation. So
you mentioned the domestic violence...
Yes, sir.
...numbers. So obviously there's some overlap in this rubric here. But so what are the trends there? What are you seeing? When have you seen this uptick?
Yes, sir.
Did it start during COVID, or what are the trends there?
Yes, COVID definitely could be a culprit, but we're also seeing everything from your traditional married spousal abuse to dating violence. Fortunately, we're not seeing a lot of child abuse yet, and when we do see that, we refer it to, of course, we're mandatory reporters. And usually the child abuse is a 16 versus 18-year-old dating a 20-year-old. So it's older child abuse. It's more of the almost consenting adult versus the actual, or a guardsman who's 17, right. You're receiving inappropriate attention from a recruiter. So we do see that, but fortunately that's the 17, 16-year-old child versus the much younger. As far as domestic violence, we are seeing an uptick. We have been training. The domestic violence is a crime. And we've been describing the behavior, just like we describe sexual assault and sexual harassment. And so that training, of course, is probably bringing it to the attention of our troops and our airmen, that when they're in a domestic violence situation, they do have rights, and we can help them with that. Unfortunately, there's no National Guard policy at this time. We do not have a family advocacy program, which typically responds clinically to domestic violence. And so the state judge advocate, the SAPR team, the front office, the TAG, his staff, we're all interested in trying to figure out how the PA National Guard will respond to domestic violence. Right now, our response is we network closely with community support. We immediately get them in touch with a domestic violence shelter so they can do safety planning with an expert. We help them through the PFA process. We'll link them up with the MidPen free legal resources or NorthPen. And then we're just with them. We help them manage their expectations, and we communicate with whatever agencies they'll allow us to. But we give them the same privileges of confidentiality that they would have as a sexual assault victim. And right now, we're not seeing sexual assault as a part of the domestic violence.
Right.
We're seeing domestic violence, emotional, physical, intimidation, coercion.
And when I'm going out to look at the community, the places that the community can help, that's one of the first things I'm looking for, because we're seeing that uptick in the domestic violence. In the forensic nurse I met with up in Williamsport, she even stated that they're seeing a lot more domestic violence cases in there, and she firmly feels that there was a lower case of COVID. These victims were stuck. They had nowhere to go. They couldn't get out of their house. They were stuck. Now that things are opening back up more, now they're being able to come out and report it and get the help that they need. So she brought up that good point that we'll probably see an increase in that. And again, as we continue to learn more about it, and you know, and just like here in Center County, I've gone out and trying to find those locations who help with domestic violence. So if I do get a case, I can get that victim the help they need.
Do you have any difficulties with, and I think, so Big Army would be a discharge for you as a separation, right? So I know in the past there's been problems with discharges that were bad conduct, that sort of thing, for sexual assault for the victim. There's a new approach to that, I would hope, and you're able
yes.
to make that a cleaner break where they can maintain their benefits and that sort
Absolutely.
Of thing.
Absolutely. It's a good point. Brings us up in January, the National Guard Bureau adapted a larger DOD policy, which is safe to report, which the command and the judge advocate would then look at the behavior. If there's collateral misconduct, collateral to the sexual assault, for example, underage drinking, maybe inappropriate conduct at the, you know, talking back to leadership, something that is non-judicial punishment, but it's minor misconduct, the commander and the SJ would look at that behavior and say, this is minor misconduct. We're going to set this aside and focus on the major crime, which is the sexual assault. And that prevents the chilling effect of that victim participating in the law enforcement investigation. Now, if it's a major crime, life, limb, eyesight, loss of theft, aircraft, things like that, that's a major consideration. The SJ would work through the commander to make sure that was dealt with separately. But as far as the characterization of service, there has to be a pretty high precedence for that victim to be held to that bad conduct or that, a general versus an honorable discharge. For example, we have a situation where the victim has been using marijuana before the assault happened, and then after the assault happened, the first admin separation board was vacated by the TAG in order to allow that victim to continue in and see if the medical evaluation board was appropriate. Unfortunately, marijuana use has continued, and so now we're up against the medical evaluation board is not appropriate because the condition that's been referred by the clinical notes is not preventing them from fit for duty. Now we're dealing with a urinalysis failure. And so right now it's up to the TAG to decide whether or not it's going to be a general or an honorable, but very patient, very takes all things into consideration and tries to make sure it's the best fit for the situation. And he has his SJA right there to help him through that process.
Thank you so much for that.
Yes, sir.
And then I would just ask, and I think you've given us a little bit, and I know Dusty's going to say don't answer this, but legislative recommendations of gaps that can be filled. Like you mentioned, that it's a challenge with the varying jurisdictions and the lack of a status. That feels like something that a state law can step in and change to be able to help you close those gaps. So you may not have things at the ready, but if you can at least identify problems where the state law might be able to be revised, and these fine folks can help guide that, anything that comes to mind, or if you want to come back around on that.
I mean, I will share.
You
that
can
we
let
just
them talk. You can let them talk.
No. Well, no, we did have, last year we got funded for a suicide prevention program. Yeah. We're doing a pilot where we're bringing in a unit, and we're going through the mental health process where we're going through bringing counselors and such in, which is another way that we can identify those who've been assaulted or who have issues, and address them as part of a whole group. So perhaps if they come in as the unit, they get the one-on-one with a counselor, maybe that will help them come forward with some of these other issues. So anything that will continue to support that would be beneficial to the National Guard. We are looking at workman's comp and trying to make some changes to our state active duty workman's comp. Been kind of holding on that because the federal government, if they do the National Guard, provide medical, mental health, and dental coverage for National Guard, that will alleviate a lot of the issues that we're having with insurances, but it still needs to be addressed. But that might be an avenue to weave some, perhaps some coverage for non-line of duty National Guard members to receive some assistance would be through that workman's comp. How it'll be specific to the Pennsylvania National Guard. That might be something that's sitting here. That's one of the things I think that we might be able to take a look at, is how that might work. But those are really the main things that we're doing. The only other thing is to help our regional coordinators get the word out, get them in front of the people within your districts, and then just help share that the resources there, because although it's embedded with the National Guard, it is a resource for all services. And that's one of the challenges we have, is how do we make sure the reservists know about those programs? How do we make sure that those that are on active duty, if there's an issue within Pennsylvania, that we can support them as well? So that's the main thing, is making sure that we're communicating what the program's doing, because we're very proud of where we're going. And we continue to work on making improvements, but adding the last wave from Congress to provide funding to provide more personnel has been a real blessing for us to be able to help more and more of our service members.
What about the jurisdictional issue that Charity addressed and Mike brought up?
We're having a meeting about that.
I do believe that we are very close to having, like I said, the first issue that we brought up, that the Adjutant General was not getting the police reports. So making any decisions on how to adjudicate a non-criminal activity was very difficult. So we did get that changed. We are now working with the Pennsylvania State Police. They seem very interested in moving forward with being the investigators for criminal sexual assault. We are working with the Commonwealth IG, or Pennsylvania IG. That's a little bit more tricky because their function is a little different than what we're asking them to do, is pretty much have an investigator available to us to do administrative investigations. But they're normally looking internal versus external, which is something we're wrestling with right now. But we're very close with the Pennsylvania State Police, and we have approached the Attorney General's office as well. They recommended that we work primarily with the Pennsylvania State Police on the criminal side. If things don't work out, we may approach them on the administrative side as well.
So because the UCMJ does not apply, so there are no courts martials, right?
That's correct.
In the Guard.
That's correct.
So a JAG could not take any action, right? It's completely at the discretion, purely. Like you said, Charity, unless it's an administrative issue. Right. Is that?
Yes. Even the senior general court martial converting authority, which should be General Schindler, he does not have the authority to hold a court martial to hold that offender accountable. We don't jail offenders. Nice. We have to rely on the local law enforcement because of that lack. Now, there is talk about possibly moving to that direction, but I think that'll be a ways down the road as we accomplish these initial hurdles to bridge the gap. But right now we have administrative authority. And then once even if the case is adjudicated unfounded by OCI, mm-hmm. So OCI has looked at it, they took what the local law enforcement started, were not able to move forward, the DA could not accept or prefer charges, OCI will look at it and they still find it unfounded, and that's about 50% of the cases. And typically it's based on victim believability. We always have the special victims counselor explain that to the victim so that they can ask those hard questions. And the next step is the commander in charge of that alleged offender, which is now no longer an alleged offender, can then look at the collateral misconduct by the alleged offender to decide what they're going to do. Was there fraternization? Was there, you know, giving alcohol to minors? And they'll hold that individual accountable at their level. So then it can go down to the division or the brigade commander to adjudicate that collateral misconduct, which is no longer sexual assault, but they're dealing with the good order and discipline of that organization.
One of the biggest challenges is the timeline from the report to the timeline that is concluded. And that's what we're trying to get after by having local in-state support. Waiting on the National Guard Bureau or some external investigation is just expands the time tremendously. So we're hoping that we can get to that point. From a command perspective, I mean, we have seen where we can expedite the process, we've been able to do so. But it's a very long, drawn-out process to make sure that we protect the victim and the person who's being accused. And that's one of the challenges that we have is the timeline that many of these continue to take.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
You guys have anything else?
Thank you.
Yeah, this is a really phenomenal job.
Thank
really,
you.
Really yeah. get given us a lot to think about, your experience, the work you do, and just the overview and the level of detail. Really appreciate the time.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Anything we can do to support your work, let us know. We'll give you our cards. Any follow-up that you have with documents for us would be really great.
I appreciate that, sir.
No, thank you.
We appreciate the committee's time.
Yes, thank you very much.
Of course.
Thank you very much. I didn't bring any cards with me.
You got some
cards
here.
And yes.
Thank you.
Oh, I have a credit card.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
No, you don't want to be leaving.
We're down that way.
Do you want to say the magic word?
Who didn't go? They got that way.
You got it?
More.
You got one already?
Oh, I think. Oh, no, I got it now.
Raise you too.
So we are adjourned. Thank you all.